Welcome to Lady Margaret Hall.
In half an hour, they're here shaving on this floor.
Obviously, my knees are turning.
Magicamente, quem tá presente, as novinhas salientes, fica loucona e se joga pra gente.
Eu falei assim pra ela.
Vai com o bumbum tam tam, vem com o bumbum tam tam tam, vai mexe o bumbum tam tam, vem desce o bumbum tam tam tam, vai mexe o bumbum tam tam, vem desce o bumbum, vai com o bumbum, vem com o bumbum.
And then here is the entrance for the rest of your life to do. Choose to apply here.
This
bed sinks, man.
No, it doesn't. That's much better. Face forwards. Okay, just start with the hellos.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Marais or Felicis Kativu, but you can call me V. I study classical archaeology and ancient history here at the University of Oxford, and in Oxford, I live at Lady Margaret Hall.
My name is Joshua Tullock. I study politics, philosophy, and economics at Lady Margaret Hall, and I'm in second year now.
We're going to take you on a short tour of LMH.
Haha, short!
Look at this, look how long we have to go. Wow! We're still going!
How'd you do that? You made it look up so small!
Let's take a short tour of LMH so you can see what the building is like. The environment, the architecture, everything. We're gonna see the church. Take it to church, yes?
Yes!
Take it to church. We're going to see the dining hall, we're going to see the gardens, see the shack, everything about LMH, it's all here, amen?
And we're going to try and weather the storm, it's raining.
It's raining,
outside.
Look, honestly.
But because Because we're so dedicated, we're just going to go outside with the camera in the rain anyway. So like...
It's because we love you guys.
And my highlighter is popping. You're blinded right now. Look, you need sunglasses.
You know what? My eyes are wide. I'm fine.
Yes. Are you ready?
Yes.
Come on.
Just go.
I don't know where to go.
Okay, so this is the porter's lodge. What is a porter? See, a lot of the time we use language that we don't even. We just. Porter? It's like. So I want to say receptionist, but it's not quite receptionist.
Ali, yes. What's a porter? Yeah, what are you?
A glorified receptionist.
That's fair enough.
Also, look after all of us. We can come down here at any time of the day and you guys are willing to help.
Sit in the bar and have a good drink with your
receptionist. Do you want to add anything else?
No.
So obviously it's been snowing, at LMH it snows all the time.
Why does it snow all the time? Because it's a winter wonderland here.
Exactly. This is our own magical kingdom. So this is where LMH all began, the first building. This is where the first 8 women were. Oh no, is it not 8?
I think it's 9 or 10.
Okay, well, some women, the first some women were taught here. There's the college built. And the first college to accept women in Oxford, and we are a revolutionary college, and that's why LMH has this kind of left, kind of liberal environment, because we've always been on the progressive side of things, and that's how the college was founded, and that's how it intends to move forward with the foundation year. The
stuff
that LMH gets involved in, the fact that LMH is now taking in more state school than private school students, so. It's all part of the whole welcoming environment, and you will feel at home here. This is Talbot Square. This is tall but tall.
Is that what it's called?
We have Eleanor Lodge over here, we have the library over there, which we'll go into very soon. Actually, let's go there now.
Wow! Oh, footwork. Footwork! Oh, wow. Legwork!
Even though Eleanor is one of the smaller libraries in Oxford, we have about 11 million books. That's not true. It's 11,000.
11 million?
11,000. Is particularly fan of that, and she has given us a recommendation of the best feminist books.
Oh, V! Studying hard as always.
Study hard, play hard, do work hard.
We'll take you to the bar.
Is the lighting good here? Is that high, what's the highlight saying?
Yeah, go on.
What's the highlight saying?
Just...
Am I popping or am I
oh
shopping?
Oh my, can you just...
Okay, welcome to the Lady Margaret Hall bar. What happens here, V? Why do you have a bar at your college? Let me tell you. Come here. Basically, we have bops here. What's a bop? What's a bop? The college funds a party for us. We have pizza, a DJ, music, we dance, we have drinks, all that jazz. And yeah, it's just a good time. Why don't you come to the bop?
And we have slur as well, look. So this is our principal, over here.
Am I live?
You are live. So this is the chapel. Every college has a chapel, but they also have multi-faith prayer rooms as well.
Back to sender!
Yes! Yes! Amen!
Back to sender.
Amen!
Back. Holy Ghost back.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Guys, come to LMH. It'll be fun. I promise. We have food. We have a church. We have a library. And a bar. Do you want to eat? Do you want to sleep? Do you want to read? Do you want to see?
We're getting to the best bit of LMH, this is the gardens. Obviously, because LMH isn't in the centre of town, there's a lot more space. We're right next to University Park, so there's a lot more space for college to build. And we've got huge gardens.
Huge!
We probably got one of the...
How many acres?
We've got the second biggest garden in Oxford, after Christchurch. That's the graduate centre over there.
What's in here? Wow.
Oh, that's sick.
The LMH secret garden.
Ta-da! Welcome to the secret gardens of LMH. So secret that everyone knows about them.
And this is the shack where the HQ of the Garden Appreciation Society.
So, first question of the many questions.
Yeah.
Why did we choose LMH?
See, I chose LMH because I felt comfortable here. So I was on the foundation year, and when it came to reapplying for university, I knew I was going to apply to Oxford, and then I knew I was going to apply to LMH just because I'd spent a year here and I felt comfortable, everyone was welcoming, this was home for me. So to go and start again at another college just didn't make sense for me. So That's why I chose LMH, because I already knew what it was like, which is a unique position to be in. But you didn't have that, so why did you?
So I chose I kind of believe that they're going to tell you basically that it doesn't matter which college you go to because it's all the same. That's not true. Every college has a unique culture, has a unique like political leaning, has a unique environment. So you really have to find the college that fits you. So
hey, I believe your mission.
I believed that it was all equal. So I was going to do an open application, but then I did some work experience with somebody who actually went to this college. And he basically recommended it. So I was like, yeah, don't really care, to be honest. But it was literally the best decision I've ever made. It's incredible. I've met friends for life. And I'm so glad that I'm here, because everyone's just so lovely. Everyone is so lovely.
My heart feels warm.
Oh, you thought I was talking about you? Oh. this is very pretty. Next question. How did you meet?
How did we meet? Okay. No, we've actually never talked about this.
We did. No, what?
I know how we met.
Yeah, I know how we met.
We met by the library steps. Mm. And you were going to like a family dinner, right?
No, Imps.
No, but
it was Imps.
I met you while you were going to your family dinner. You're having an Indian or something, and you had a plate in your hand. And you were either coming from it or going from it. And I was like, why you got a plate in your hand? And you were like, family dinner. I actually went after him.
We gotta be friends.
No, I'd been here a week earlier than everyone else, so I already knew the grounds. I was already, you know, situated or whatever, you know. I didn't need introductions and all of these, you know, freshers talks. So I was scouting. I was like, where is the melanin? I'm finna make sure I know everybody. So when I saw him, it's hard to miss. Do you know what I mean? He's very tall. So
that's
when
why I saw my hair can't fit in this.
I was like, think of something. So I was like, why did you have a plate in your hand?
Imagine.
Hook.
She got me.
Yeah, that's how we met.
How did you feel before coming to LMH?
You go first.
Okay. I was terrified. I genuinely terrified. I was scared that it was going to be the Oxford type of person, you know, the stereotypical person. And I had my walls up. I was ready not to make any friends. I was ready to get my degree and go. That was my whole mission was get your degree, study, stay in your room, home. That's it. And that kind of put me at a disadvantage, because I felt like when I came into Freshers Week, I wasn't really as friendly as open as I could have been, because I was expecting a certain type of person.
Your prestige.
It's actually a problem. Like I thought people couldn't relate with me, but like within a day, it was just clear that it wasn't true.
Yeah.
Because I was quite lucky, because with my PPE group, everyone, it's not necessarily a multicultural group in the conventional sense, but everyone comes from different cultures. So we've got someone from Wales, someone from France, someone from Singapore, someone from the North, someone who's spent like 3 years in Swaziland, going to school there. Someone from Thailand, someone from Manchester. So like, basically every walk of life is basically represented, and I'm here.
Hey, Peckham, come on.
We made it. But yeah, no. I was actually really scared. And you?
Oh, that's so cute. I didn't know that. Because you literally were walking tall, and you know, you were really looking like, I don't care. For me, I was scared. I remember crying like the day before I came to LMH the first time. I was just so scared because I didn't know what to expect. And because I was coming in on the foundation year as well, I thought there's going to be a stigma around why I'm here and the course I'm on, and everyone's going to think, she's lowering the standards of Oxford, why is she here, I just felt like I would be really stupid and people wouldn't want to get to know me because they just wouldn't think I was a real student. So once again, our fears were different because we were coming from different like perspectives. But the second time I was coming into LMH as a fresher, I was just nervous that, I just felt like I wouldn't fit in. I thought everyone would talk the same language in terms of going to the horse races, playing croquet, going to wine and cheese, and I would be like, yo, man's not on that, you know? So that's why I was scared, but like Josh said, it's really, really not like that. Everyone here is really like chilled.
Mm.
The majority are very chilled.
Majority.
Yeah, majority. We can't, you know.
Obviously, you're not going to... No, it's perfect. You're going
to
find
We're not
few,
here to be like...
You're going to make a few side eyes, like, what you're saying, but at the same time...
The amount of times I have to explain what I mean when I say, you know, you're doing bits, or why I wear sliders with socks, or certain things that I do, I have to keep explaining myself. But other than that, I mean... Yeah.
So we talked about before LMH, now you're LMH, how do you feel? I think we've covered that, haven't we? It's actually amazing. It's like, it's not perfect, obviously.
Of course not.
The food is really good. We have kitchens.
The food is good. I wouldn't...
Okay, the food is...
No, it's true. We're not here to lie on.
Actually, no, we're not. Listen, sometimes you like bring some salt to the dining hall and like...
But the food is good. I like it a lot, actually. And the people are very nice. And like Josh said, people do come from different walks of life. Maybe not certainly different, you know, races, but different walks of life in their race. Mm. So it's nice to have people from working class backgrounds, people from state schools, people from private schools. It's nice to have private school friends sometimes because you get to learn stuff.
And honestly, like some of the most generous, most amazing people I've met have been private school, like super rich.
Yeah.
The thing about LMH, what I really like about it is that once you're here, there's a level of mutual respect.
I love it when you say that.
That's what it is. It's the mutual respect. It's, you've been good enough to get into Oxford. So as long as you are nice, you will make friends. That's just the key. As long, just be nice. You don't have to, you don't have to show off in every conversation and show that you're intellectual. Just be you, because you are here and everyone respects the fact that you made it here.
And one of the things I really love, like going off of what you're saying, is since I've been in this place, not one person has ever asked me about my grades. It doesn't matter. I don't know anyone's grades in this place. Once you're here, it literally does not matter how you've got here or where you've came from. It's not like a, did you get 90% in that C2 paper or did you not? Because I won't be your friend. No one cares. The fact that you're in this place means you've gone through something to get here, and that you've already got your badge of respect for that, and that's it.
What were your interviews like? So, interviews, IDPP, so I had 3 interviews, one for each. It was interesting. Certainly, they did not all go well. One was okay, one was quite terrible, one was good, so it was a real mixed bag. My philosophy interview was just a mess. The guy asked me, if all bananas are yellow and all non-bananas are non-yellow, can you have evidence for one without having evidence for the other?
If all bananas are yellow and all
non-bananas are non-yellow, can you have evidence for one without having evidence for the other? I was like, I blinked at this man.
How do you even start tackling that?
And
what did you say?
The thing is, that's the thing about interviews, is that if you don't understand, just say. So I was like, can you clarify?
And can you actually clarify? Because I really
haven't. Oh, no, me, I left that interview thinking I'd not got a place. But honestly, the people who came out of interviews going, wow, that was amazing, they're not here. I can't see you. So they'll push you to a point where you don't even know what's going on.
Where you're just like, I can't think anymore. Yeah. They want to challenge you. Otherwise, if they can't push you and they can't challenge you, then go do a PhD. Yeah, like, why aren't you applying for a master's?
If you have the answers, then
Who wants to teach someone who knows it all? Do you get it? They want to teach you stuff. They want you to come in with a fresh mind, willing to learn. The most important thing is, I don't know the answers, but I am willing to work.
I said that three times. Three times in my interview, I was like, I don't know what's going on.
But I would do everything. But
I would love to learn. Please teach me. And also ask a question. That's top tip. Ask a question at the end. How were your interviews?
I had 2 sets. So I had my foundation year interviews, which were over Skype because I was in America and I couldn't make it to LMH, so they had to Skype it, girl. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, my second set, which were here, they were terrible. I can't lie to you. Listen. Me, I was just minding my business, eating my, you know, my hot dog in the canteen or whatever, the hall. Chilling. I'm like, my interview's tomorrow. I'm straight chilling. Everything is good. And my tutor looks at me, her eyes open. I said, Claudia, what's the problem? She said, V, why are you here? I said, what do you mean? She said, V, you are currently in an interview at Brazenose right now. Like, your interview has begun. I said, what? She said, you're missing your pre-reading. The way I had to get up, run to my room while I was on the phone to a taxi, change, go downstairs. Meanwhile, my interview has begun. I had to get in the taxi, go. The man tells me, I can't take you any further because, you know, it's hard for taxis to go up there. And I'm like, so what are we doing? He said, you're going to have to walk. Do I ever know where prisoners is? Have I ever been to prisoners? Have I ever been to prisoners? I walk in, they're like, oh, you've missed your pre-reading and you're 5 minutes into your interview. So I walked into the interview and they were like, so this interview is not going to be personal statement based, we're just going to talk about the pre-reading in this one. I said, oh, okay. the one I didn't...
Excuse me? I didn't do
the pre-reading that you're talking about. So he said, it's fine, I'm sure you can pick up. Bearing in mind, pre-reading is usually a random extract that you've never seen because they want everyone to be on the, you know, an equal level playing field. So they try and pick something that people wouldn't know. So now I'm supposed to analyze this piece of paper in front of you, first time seeing it. Anyway, the interview goes on. He keeps asking me questions I don't know the answers to. It was horrible.
But you're here now. You made it.
And I left when I left the interview, I just burst into tears. The minute that the door closed, my eyes, the porter was just like, he just felt so sorry for me, but I was crying. And I went straight to the museum because that's where I go, whether I'm happy or sad. I like to go to the museum. And I called my sister. I went to the museum and I was looking around and I was like, this is my last time in Oxford, basically. Like, I had to enjoy the moments because I was like, that's it, I'm not getting in. Called my sister and she said, listen, babe, you've given it your best shot. She was like, I'm sure it's fine, but I can only go for what you tell me. And if that's what really happened, then, you know, it's what God's plan was for you. And yeah, that was it. That was my last interview. And I was like, I'm not coming here. But apparently, they called my tutors and told them that it was a really good interview.
So the next question is, what are bops? What's a bop?
So when we... Do that one more time.
So my life is just constantly in danger.
No, it's not. So we...
Just clarify.
So we often Snapchat, oh, bop time, bop, bop, bop. And people are like, what are bops? That's why.
So many of you have been asking, because... It's just such a bit of an overwhelming response.
So we're going to show you what bops are in 2 seconds time, but they are big organized parties and they're arranged by your college. They pay for it. They buy you pizza, food, drinks, and we kind of go down with party. It ends at 11:30 because of curfew. Mm.
And so it's kind of like a massive pre. So you have the party in the bar and then sometimes on Fridays we have jazz night as well. And then we got bop the next day. So the 25th of November, and the weeks before that, Oxford just goes crazy for Oxmas, where they pretend it's December.
Oxford Christmas.
And so there's Christmas carols, there are trees, everything you would have at Christmas is here in November, before we've even begun December, it's here. So we have the Oxmas family formal.
Let me tell you why we do that. It's not just...
What's a family formal? They get our families up? Or what are these families talking about?
I'll tell you, but after I explained Oxmas, because you explained it wrong. First of all, Oxmas is a play on words. Oxford, Christmas, put it together, Oxmas. Clever.
We're very clever here.
They
we're
say
the cleverest.
We're the cleverest. And then the reason why we have Oxmas in November is because uni closes on the 1st or the 3rd of December. So we wouldn't have time to celebrate together. That's why we do it in November while we're here.
So, the Oxmas weekend.
That was so much attitude.
We had the Oxmas family formal and the fat. So,
fat is not. Why is it called family formal? I'll tell them.
Okay.
It's called family formal because at Oxford we have a college system whereby you have parents. They're just students who are in the year above and they look after you. You have siblings, you have grandparents sometimes, you have absentee parents who are in France for the year or something, on a year abroad.
It's okay.
I know it burns. I don't know my dad. Where's my dad? So basically,
the stereotypes are not.
They don't escape us.
Single parent household.
They never escape
it's tough.
Us.
It's tough.
But God has us all.
Amen.
Yes. So basically, at Oxmas, we have a family formal where the college parents, who are the people in the year above, take their college children, the year below, they take them to a formal dinner, they sit down, they have Christmas dinner, they. What do they do?
So basically it's a 3-course meal where, so we just sit down as a college family, have Christmas dinner.
Yeah.
And then afterwards we had jazz night. And then the day after that we had the bop, the Christmas bop or the Oxmas bop. And then after that people go out. And then on the Sunday was a Christmas gaudy.
What's a gaudy, Josh?
A gaudy is for the second years and third years, it's like a free Christmas dinner that the college gives you.
So you went to the...
No. So instead of the gaudy, right, I went to the ACS end of term committee dinner, which you also see.
It's all wild, but enough from us. Why don't you just take a look?
So this is Dan, our other social sec. He's in charge of all, like, social things. And this is... Now, hall is slowly taking shape. We've got Hannah over here, our other social sec, in charge of all social activities for the college.
One of the quirks of going to Oxford is that we form families. So second years get married, then they get assigned first year children to look after them. So this is my wife.
Hello.
Naomi, she does psychology. And yeah, so if you do apply here, that's one of the things you've got to look forward to. An early marriage. I'm actually a home wrecker. Like, she actually divorced her former husband for me. And yeah, it's a bit. But you know, when this is on offer, who can resist? Not her, she couldn't resist. To my kids, Ryan from Texas.
Yes, sir.
International. Leah from Spain.
Hello.
International.
Bring your lady to zero below, yeah, only in a go. Ring, ring, I know, when she hit the phone. What? Just push it on, salt on the streets, Tim's on my feet. Best time to give, shot town it is. Fam all around, tryna run the town. Loud how it smells, space all we live. Bucket full of wings, tryna get about 5 golden rings. Ballin' for the cheers, drink some. Get your smoke on, when a break, no school zone. Footwork, yeah, and get your step on. Yeah, yeah. Merry Christmas, this is what we call a shutdown piece.
So formal is over, we're just going to head over to jazz night, which is an LMH speciality. Here we go. Okay, so we have the world's fastest talker right here.
So, occasionally because they have this record, we're going to smoke a record to talk quick. And people want to talk really fast. And I say, well, what do you think of talking fast? Maybe memorize what we say. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about. Maybe I just could think of the old topic, just talk really quick. But then again, maybe I could. Fair
enough. Okay, he wasn't kidding.
Literally.
You're cooking it in orange juice. I'm not sure how I feel about that.
See, look, orange juice is what you do. You manage to get just an S, just a little citrusy.
Oh my God.
So I'm going to marinate it in marmalade, honey, a bit of jerk seasoning, a bit of aroma as well. And here we are. 2.5 hours.
This is just a PSA. Just don't leave the stove unattended because you will make a mess.
Stop it!
Come here. You know how it is. Kick, foot down, kick, don't look down. Take a step back, come back round. Who taught you how to step? Go ahead, go ahead.
This Christmas, baby, I can't let this song come between friends. If I'm part of your holiday plans, let's roll down, make sure I'm trying.
Everyone's actually made an effort.
Michigan Avenue, hold my hand. Take the red line from 95th to the end. Let it snow now. Yeah. Girl, skip the Uber, I'ma pick you up. Ask me where I'm going and where with ya. I'ma get the money till it brings the truck. Will you be my honey and love? We get stuck. We've been through problems, we can test enough. Drinks to the sky, we give.
Hey!
a prayer.
Oh, I know. Come back. Okay. The ACS, are they bougie? Oh, what's an interesting word.
They be bad and bougie or whatever. I don't like none of the ACS. That's why I stay in my room. Especially like the vice presidents and stuff. They are like, I mean, no, the ACS is lovely. It's like my friends from back home, you know?
You go to get good vibes, good food, good music, the club night.
It's just a family. You feel like you're a family, honestly. Yeah. And you know that you're in a situation and a space where you do have to stick together and kind of lean on each other for support. So it's nice that everyone has an understanding of what our roles are, and we play those roles very well. We have welfare, we have vice presidents, we have presidents, we have people who organize sponsorship events. We kind of cover every aspect of life and make sure that we have those support systems in place. Just in case you do want to turn up, we have events for that. Just in case you do want to talk about your academic progress, we have things in place for everything, you know? And it's kind of like a university within a university, if that makes sense. Yeah. For me anyway, that's what the ACS feels like.
So this year we have the freshers who've come in. They're like a family. They did their own Christmas dinner. Then we had the official ACS Christmas dinner.
Yeah.
We also had the end of term Christmas formal for the ACS committee. And we'll let you see that now.
Hey! Come on, she's succulent.
The camera's really messed up.
I'm so sorry. I'm trying to capture it.
We're actually snapping.
And this is Yathrib, our welfare officer, looking lovely as usual, and Serge looking, you know, as Serge does.
Look at us, imagine.
And this is Maudlin, where we will be formaling today.
Do you know we're supposed to wear a tie?
You meant it's black tie now.
Black tie.
Is that what? Did you not read anything that Yathrib sent you? Look at this boy. See, this is what I'm talking about, Serge. Look at this boy. It's come open collar.
Who are we waiting for?
Wait. No. Oh, who's that? Oh my god.
Is that who? Oh, hey!
Got about three hoes on my sleigh. I'm trying to tee up Christmas Day. Want some finger bells all the way. Hey. Got them bells all on the shake. Got about three hoes all the way. Hey. Got about three hoes in my sleigh. Hey. Legs up, the Hello Kitty, hell yeah, I'm gonna prove, yeah, yeah, it's cover season, hell yeah, but you got a man, yeah, yeah, tell him get spread up, I'm in the spirit, yeah.
Really a mess.
Can you? Thank you very much
for this one.
He
went demanding more bread.
The thing is like £13. Yeah,
schools is it? Say no.
I don't play.
Legs up.
See my face.
Hell yeah.
Have a seat.
Yeah, yeah.
Make a plate.
Hell yeah.
She can't wait.
Yeah, yeah.
Still awake.
Spread up.
Oh my god.
Yeah, yeah.
Christmas Day.
Say no. Jingle bells all the way.
All the way.
Hey. On your hips, y'all make that shake.
I'll make it shake.
Got about three hoes on my sleigh.
Up on my sleigh.
And try to tee up Christmas Day.
I'll give me day.
Don't you want some jingle bells all the way?
All the way.
Shake. Got them bells all on the shake.
I'll give me day.
Shake. Got about three hoes all the way.
Up on the
shake. Got about three hoes in my sleigh.
You, we're not actually playing. What are we doing?
I think you made it a little bit more practical.
It's too childish. I can't risk my wig coming.
The elephant in the room, is it racist here? Very good question. Very good question. No, not overtly. I wouldn't say it's.
Systematically, of course.
Of course, Oxford is, as an institution, has its own problems.
But the people.
Interacting with people, the people have been brilliant, but obviously, I think there's a. It's not bigotry, but it's. There are problematic areas that come from people not being exposed to certain cultures. Things that can be fixed through education. So people will ask you certain questions.
People will do certain things.
They'll do like, certain things. Don't touch.
That's what people be doing. You'll be like, you've just reached your own human hand to now be set. Yeah. Without even us, like as if I'm just here ready for you to pet when like you can't do that, you know?
But yeah, as long as you assert your boundaries,
yeah,
and you make sure people know what you will and won't stand for.
There's so few of you, you tend to be noticed more, and then that's where the issues of like exotifying come from. It's because you're the different, you're the other, so people are curious. And even me, like I always go back to hair, but every time I change my hair, it becomes a spectacle in this place, and I'm just like. Just let me be. At this point, you should know that that's just me and part of my culture. That I, as a girl, as a black girl, will change my hair often, protective styling and whatnot. Like, that's just what we do. But other than that, there's nothing. No one will come up to you and use the N-word or say, get out of my cut. All the kind of, like, racist things that you think of. No one does that, but it's more. What's the term I'm looking for? Microaggression?
It's micro. There's nothing macro, but the micro is problematic, but.
Yeah.
As long as you make sure you set your boundaries and you just, I mean, it's nothing you can't handle. It's nothing you're not going to experience in the real world. Oxford isn't any different to the outside world.
Yeah.
And a lot of the things, it's people who are just not used to certain cultures. And if you talk to them in a reasonable manner, honestly, the problem's solved from day one.
Especially, it's not just that you're black and you're not white, it's the fact that you're black and you also come from a different kind of culture and you also come from a different type of school. You didn't go to private, so already you don't speak the right language of like, you know, formal dinners and whatnot. So it's just, you have to kind of break those barriers down. But since we are making this video, like, let's get personal. Like, what has been the worst moment for you as a black man navigating this space?
I think it's not necessarily been external, it's been largely an internal battle, in as much as I'm aware of myself as a black man, a tall black man in Oxford with big hair, walking around the streets, walking into certain colleges, because some colleges, they're culturally very, very different to LMH. Yeah. So LMH politically is quite left liberal, but other colleges are more conservative, more right wing. And I feel that there's definitely an atmosphere change, definitely an environment change. You go to certain colleges, you feel that there's a more of a hostility in a way.
It's the constant checks.
Yeah.
Are you a student here?
Yeah.
Are you at Brooks? It's constant.
I think the worst moment for me is getting used to the environment and kind of getting past the imposter syndrome and kind of, I don't know, unburdening myself from the idea that I represent all black people, because I am the only black male in my year. It's like, honestly, no, but statistically speaking, if I fail, 100% of black boys have failed in this year in Oxford, in LMH. So like, statistically speaking, there's a lot on my side. There are what? How many of us are there? Four. So it's like, between 5 and 10 of us, right, out of, what, 300? But I'm like 400 in the entire college, right? And statistically speaking, if one of us fails, that's 10% of the entire intake. They just failed. And that's why the ACS is so important, because the ACS is a support structure. Like, you, honestly, you get to know every black person in Oxford. If at any time you're having any issues that people who are not of your culture won't necessarily understand. You can go to anyone and see, like, yo, this what happened. Like, let's chat about it. Overall, generally, LMH is lovely. It's incredible.
Oh, yeah, LMH is like, the diverse one of the Oxford colleges.
I mean, unlike other Oxford colleges, they're actually putting their money where their mouth is. They're spending millions and millions and millions on
different initiatives.
And they're really being creative. It's not perfect, but at the same time, when you're in a space at Oxford, it's so difficult to get away from that bubble. But honestly, it's a really welcoming environment, and
it's great.
It's great.
That's it.
Question is, where do we get our hair done? We don't. I said we do, but like, go back to London,
sis,
or whatever.
Let me tell you. The gag is, we don't get our hair done here because there's nowhere to get your hair done, okay? I am lucky enough to just carry hair with me. So I have my extensions, like my braids in there if I need to get my hair cameoed so I can get a weave put on. I have my wigs. Shout out to my sister. She makes all my wigs. I have fake hair that looks like natural hair so I can fool people. I even fooled you.
Oh, yeah. No, I was like,
when did you find out?
I didn't even, when I came in this room and I saw that, I was like, wait. Wow. Even I was fooled.
I carry my fake hair because otherwise I wouldn't be able to get my hair done. So I just have bits of wig, weave, hair piece here and there. What do you do?
I go to London. To be fair, there are two barber shops in Oxford, and there was a Nigerian guy there, he did a very decent cut, very very far away. I mean, it's like a 7 mile cycle all like all around, and
at that point
much.
You might as well go to London.
But if you get a cab, share a cab, it's fine. It's like $2.50 each.
Thank you so much for watching our ACS vlogs. I've been V, he's been
Josh. Oh, wow.
I'm V, he's Josh. This is our ACS Vlogs college tag for Lady Margaret Hall. This is the best college in Oxford. Yes, I said it. Renee and Florin, come for me. What's good,
Keeble College?
Where are your kitchens? Non-existent.
I can't.
But yeah, the best college. And if you come here, you can hang out with us.